I wish you much success. Really, I do.
I'm sorry, Jess. I'm sorry it worked out.
No, you're not. Not really. We both did what we needed to do. I just never imagined growing old without you.
Here they play a pretty tough brand of baseball in Ohio. So I'll come watch you play often, I promise.
Okay.
He never did come out to Ohio, but he wrote to me every week for years. He missed us at first, but he quickly took to being his own man and dedicating himself completely to his work. Dope, he used to call it. Work, sex, religion, they all were dope as far as he was concerned. The legal narcotics human beings used to forget the pain of their existence. And he freely admitted he was as addicted as the next person. His private practice flourished. When he wasn't off somewhere fighting the labor wars, he'd be home in Chicago, taking on the poor and indigents that no one else would. They called him the attorney for the damned.
So when they started toward the house, Raymond got his gun.
Did he warn them before he started firing, Mrs. Jackson?
Yes, sir. He yelled and screamed and shot in the air. But it didn't do no good. They just kept a coming until Raymond... until those two white men fell dead. He worked hard for what he's got. He deserves to live wherever he wants.
It's too bad his neighbors didn't think so.
Don't worry, Mrs. Jackson. I won't let them hang your son.
Okay.
You take good care of her now.
Not a good idea to give her so much hope, Darrow.
Well, you don't think so, do you, Edgar?
No, I don't.
Well, then you'll be mighty disappointed when I win the case.
Unlikely.
I've got to get over to the American.
Such rubbish in that paper. I hate the fact we represent them.
Well, we don't represent them, Edgar. I do. But just keep reminding yourself when you're not writing poetry that it's Hearst's money that pays the bills. But while I'm gone, why don't you drop a brief on the Jackson case?
What time will you be back?
Late. Yeah. But that's okay, because Sisman will stand help, won't you, Peter?
Yes, sir.
Oh, that'll be a big help.
The founding fathers, whom we celebrate on the 4th of July, came to this country of their own free will. Yet there are others who helped build this country whom we do not celebrate. These were captured like beasts, torn from their homes and families and brought here like so much cargo to suffer generations of hardship, misery, and abuse. Yet they cleared our land, tilled our soil, planted and harvested our crop. Some even raised our children. No, we do not celebrate these. We revile them. Suppose you were a Negro. Suppose every day of your life you sat down to supper with your parents and your grandparents, and you saw in their eyes and on their bodies the scars of bondage and hatred visited upon them by white men. And then suppose a mob of white men attacked your home, where your wife and children lay in their beds. What would you do? The law has made the Negro equal, but man has not. Gentlemen, you are here to exercise the law and leave aside your prejudice.
Thank you, Mr.
Congratulations, Mr. Darrow.
Thank you, Miss.
My name is Ruby Hammerstrom. I write for the Evening Post. I wonder if I might ask you a couple of questions.
Certainly, I'd be delighted.
Wonderful. Perhaps there's a place nearby we can go?
Yes, you were in the courtroom.
You're really, really...
Well, I appreciate it.
Oh, my. I wasn't expecting this.
Well, you want to make a run for it? I hope you don't mind. It's the American. Okay. Sorry, Smitty.
Are you sure it's all right for me to be in here?
What a question from a woman in your profession. Harry, send over a couple of glass of sherry, all right, for you, Miss Hammerstrom.
Actually, I'm a shot and beer gal myself.
Really? Harry, make that two beers and two shots of your best whiskey. And send over a couple of towels. We're soaked to the skin here. I couldn't have been more than 4 or 5. He'd hide the runaway slave in a secret compartment he'd build into his wagon, and then he'd sit me up next to him. We'd go along the next stop on the Underground Railroad. Nobody thought to stop us.
I guess you come by your convictions honestly. Your father sounds like a good man.
The village infidel, they used to call him. Whatever the town did, he went the other way. He just died last year.
I'm sorry.
What about you? How do you come to be a journalist instead of some lucky man's wife?
Well, I left home when I was 18, and writing was the one thing I knew how to do, so I came to Chicago and started knocking on doors.
Just up and left, did you?
That's right. I never much cared for baking pies and shoveling manure.
Oh, you're quite of an independent mind, aren't you?
I guess you could say so.
Well, I'm a writer myself, you know. I just never find time for it. One of these days, though, I'm going to give up the law altogether and, you know, devote full time to it.
Really?
May I have this dance, Miss Hammerstrom? It's all right. We're all old friends here. It's all right.
I don't...
Come on.
I don't know.
Here we go.
I'm sure this is a good idea. I've heard that you're very courteous to the press, sir. You don't suppose this is what they were talking about, do you? Come
well,
on.
Well, I still say it looks better on me, but if you insist.
I'm afraid I must. Thank you. Well, Mr. Darrow, thank you for the interview and the dance.
Not so formal. Drop the mister. Just call me Darrow.
You don't like your first name?
I think of it as a curse.
Oh. All right, then. Darrow.
How about dinner tomorrow night? No business, just pleasure.
Mr. Darrow, I'm afraid that wouldn't be possible. You see, I'm engaged to be married.
You're kidding. Well, you're just going to have to call that off. We've only just met.
Come now. We both have reputations to uphold. Good night, sir.
Miss Hammerstrom. Ruby, you should know that I'm a very persistent fellow.
Good night, Mr. Darrow.
Good night, Miss Hammerstein.
Here you are, Mr. Darrow. I chose them all by myself.
Are you sure these are big enough? Edgar, what do you think? All right. My tickets. What do I do with my tickets?
Right here, where you left them.
God. Box seats.
The opera?
Third base, Edgar.
Mr. Darrow, this wire came for you.
My dear sir, as my heart belongs to another, I must respectfully decline.
It's from John Mitchell. United Mine Workers. They finally got the mine owners to go to arbitration after 6 months on the strike. They want me to represent them.
Where?
Scranton, Pennsylvania.
How long?
I haven't said I'd do it yet.
How long, Darrow?
Probably 3 months.
How much?
Enough to get by. Lillian, get your pad. We're going to draft an answer right away. Sisman.
Sir.
Here's 2 tickets to the ball game. Take the afternoon off. On your way, bring these to Miss Hammerstrom. Tell her that I had an emergency, but I will see her at 5 o'clock. Edgar, help me draft a response, will you?
My dear sir, as my heart belongs to another, I must respectfully decline.
Edgar! I will write you every day.
Don't be silly. You won't have time for that.
Every day?
I wish you wouldn't.
Have you set a date yet?
Soon.
Soon you're to be married, or soon you intend to set a date?
Set a date.
Give him his ring back.
What?
It's the only right thing to do.
I beg your pardon.
Well, don't worry. I'll provide the postage, but you're going to have to write the Dear John.
Mr. Darrow, please.
Well, all right. I'll write the letter.
Honestly, you are relentless. Here we are.
Ruby, I'm going to be gone for 3 months. Come with me.
Impossible.
You sure?
I'm sure.
Well, then please don't do anything foolish while I'm gone.
Good luck in Pennsylvania, Mr. Darrow.